what we're doing is we're bringing people together, on a common ground. People with different expertise, knowledge, experiences, and what we do is we pool in everything for the greater good, for a collective effort. And with the organization and direction, all the wheels turning at the same time, for the sake of time, we get much more accomplished. And we're adopting a belief system of, instead of individualism, interdependence. We want to learn how to work amongst each other again. So what we're doing is we've devised a blueprint for social change. It regulates social, political, economic, and spiritual. So our main thing is to establish an economic base. So when situations come about in the community, as in things that need to be funded, we can throw capital behind it and get things done in a more sophisticated manner. So right now we're just coming together on a common ground to figure out how we can get hair care products and organic cosmetics out there. So kind of get our people away from, these harmful products that we tend to put in our body, which causes certain diseases as cancer, other forms of diseases that we suffer from, pesticides, chemicals, or whatever. So one of our first endeavors is to create a stronger presence in the community. We're going to organize a fashion show. We're going to raise consciousness through the culture. We want to reach our young people. We want to bridge the gap between college students and at-risk youth. We want to bridge the gap between older generation and younger generation. We want to bridge the gap between rich and poor. We want to be the conduit and tear down all barriers and bring us together as a whole for the same common interest, which is to improve the conditions of the community and create a better future for our kids.
What you trying to call it?
We're calling Amalgamated Order.
Amalgamated Order.
Mm-hmm.
Alhamdulillah. What do you think needs to be done about the black violence that's going on in the city?
The black violence, well, we were sitting around and we was talking to the kids down on Market, and we talked to some kids down at the California Community Center Friday. So, I like to hear from them, see where they at with it, we shoot thought-provoking questions, and the main thing that I hear from them is a lack of, whether it be a lack of structure, lack of positive role models, lack of finances, lack of this, lack of that, that we're lacking in so many different areas. So our main thing is to figure out what areas that we lacking in as a people and make sure that our people's needs is being met. That way, it builds up greater self-confidence, self-worth, self-esteem. And when one starts respecting and loving himself, he'll respect and love his brother.
What they saying that's lacking the most? What y'all hearing out there the most?
Unity, togetherness.
Unity and togetherness.
And also, we had posed a question, and we had asked them to write down what are some of the most positive things, write down five positive things that you see in your community and in your life. And people said, family, structure, unity. And one girl, which really caught my attention, she said, only thing I see in life is negativity. And once we opened up about the negativity, they were able to talk more about the negativity versus the positive. It was a long conversation about the negativity, about, the killing, even for the youth. Killing is normal to them because they see it so much.
Yeah, especially TV.
Yeah. In the video games. The video games, the music, it desensitizes you to it. So, it's nothing for them to walk up to a murder scene and, it's just another occurrence. But, it's abnormal. It's very traumatic. It causes psychological damage. We don't have any arenas where we can come to where we can express how we truly feel about what's going on in our community. And I think that's another key component, is giving these kids an opportunity, not just the kids, but, just overall members of the community, somewhere we can come and be honest about the way we feel about what's going on and let them express it however they need to express it, whether it be through cursing or, hollering or however they need to get it out. Let them get it out. You know what I mean?
So you think that, say, like when I was growing up, what our thing was, we had a crew, mm-hmm. a group and a neighborhood crew. Mm-hmm. The way we expressed it was through music.
Yeah.
Because I was a DJ. I made the music, mm-hmm. you know, like I'm doing now. And I got all this equipment. I had all this equipment back then. Mm-hmm. And we expressed it through rap music.
Absolutely.
And it, basically, that's how we came into Black Power Movement, Nation Islam, through listening to KRS-One, Public Enemy, okay. Ice Cube, all of them. Mm-hmm. And like, I remember the minister was saying one time, he said that the leaders of the youth people are the rappers,
yeah.
the music industry.
Yeah.
So if they are teaching foolishness, money, sex, violence, every, you know, to please them mm-hmm. so they can get a paycheck.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Then I can see why they would talk like that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it comes to the point where it's like, you know, life imitating art. You know, we all know that, you know, due to social engineering, the Jews think that, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? And they finance these rappers to talk like that, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? So this has been the game, you know, this is what we up against as people in the community that's really fighting for what's right, you know, on that righteous path. This is what we up against, you know, mm-hmm. That's the most important tool that they have is the media, you know what I mean? You know, brainwashing our children to believe and think and, you know, create a false illusion about what life is, a false sense of security about life. But we must take responsibility as being men in our community to jump down in these trenches and get at our youth directly and let them know, because it's evident that this is not the path. Mm-hmm. But if they don't have nothing to compare with, it's like the options is bleak. You know what I mean? Yes, another way, but nobody's showing them another way. Nobody is doing anything productive. There's nothing, you know. It's like, you know, this is all they see, and this is why they can speak about the negativity so much, because this is all they, you know, this is all they being exposed to. So what we want to do is we want to, like I said, be that bridge, that conduit, you know what I mean, and go reach for people that are experts in different arenas.
With a plan of action.
With a plan of action, you know what I'm saying? And like you said, it's ironic, where we was at the community center, it was a program based around poetry and rapping and, you know, giving them, you know, a more productive way, creative way to express themselves. So, you know, kind of, you know, more social redeeming theme, you know, other than just, you know, talking about grabbing a bag and a gun. Now, really express yourself, you know, reach down in the pit of your soul and come honestly, you know what I mean? Not just, you know, because we not here, we're going to leave our egos at the door.
Exactly.
We're going to leave our egos at the door, and we're going to be all the way honest. Like, we're going to be truthful in here, you know what I mean? How do you really feel about the loss of your homeboy? How do you really feel about your father not being in your life? How do you really feel about your mother strung out on dope? How do you really feel about your condition? Let's be honest. Let's, you know. Right. No, that's it.
Okay, brother Belair.
Yes, sir.
You the elder here. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Back in your day, it wasn't this much violence. It was drugs, but not like this. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It was guns, but it wasn't like this.
Right, yeah.
What is the difference from your time and from this time as you was growing up?
Yeah, well, it was quite unique for the simple reason, right? You know, coming from the era from the 60s and the 70s. And like I said, in the consciousness of the 60s, you know, it was about doing for self. It was about, you know, black power, black love, unification, until we came into like the mid-70s. And this is when the what we call the black exploitation, this is when the Superfly, this is when the cocaine and all this phenomena took place. And so therefore, after that, it's been downhill ever since. And see, they have always used this tool. And I say they, speaking about our enemies, I should say those who wish us harm, they've always come with the drugs into our communities. And see, that's what happened to the Panther Party.
Yeah.
So this is why it's important. I tell anybody who is starting an organization, if you're trying to do some positive change, you have to have a moral code. Because that way, that protects you from them coming into your ranks and destroying you. Because they're going to bring the white women, women in general, and they're going to bring the drugs.
You know this in the West End, how they done flooded the West End with white women.
I mean, it's classic.
From they come from the the Women's Recovery Place.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Reverend Coleman. I mean, not Reverend Coleman, but St. Stephen Baptist Church.
Cosby.
Yeah, Reverend Kevin Cosby.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Back then, when Khalid Muhammad came to Louisville, mm-hmm, you know, I was doing security for him, you know.
Okay.
Because, you know, I was in suit, coat, tie.
Okay, uh-huh.
And he had the red, black, and green flag up there.
Who did?
Reverend Kevin Cosby.
Oh, really? Not no more.
Man. he took it down, mm-hmm, and today it's flooded with white women.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, from the recovery. You can see them walking from the recovery program.
From here, from here. Right, exactly.
Going down there in packs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it's strange. He don't want nothing to do with talking about black affairs. A black person got shot by the police.
It's painful.
Well,
it's
you got to look at that state of the art. The demonstration he got down there.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's like this here. You know, when you got people, man, that's not grounded, man, it's so easy to surround them, man. You know, you got people, they throw money at them. They throw money at us for us to stop today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, you know.
You know what I mean? But it's like, is the cause deeper than a piece of paper with the slave master's face on it?
Yeah.
Huh? How deep is the cause for real?
Yeah.
Is the cause just, you know, something just to talk about, have a good time, have a meeting, make this brother feel good? Is it just good talk?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I always say this, man, this is a repeated thing. We have to go past the talk. We have to even go past the just meeting to be meeting.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
This is why what this brother right here is presenting is very good, because it's something that's structured, and he's open for a suggestion to add on. Mm-hmm. And it's a plan of action. It's not just something where it's just, you know, we going this way and this is what this is about. It's deeper than that, because you got people, man, that's in the heart of this, you know, that's hurting and suffering, you know.
That's
but
right.
If there's no plan of action and it's just talk about, okay, this is what need to be done, this is the enemy, this is what the enemy is doing, we know that.
Mm-hmm.
So we know we got to have a defense mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
Where is it? Is it being put in place?
Mm-hmm.
It is now, because I'm part of it. I'm making action. Is the school system being put in place? Yeah, now I'm involved.
Mm-hmm.
But just the talking and talking and getting together just for the good talk, that's over with.
Yeah.
This is what we presenting here.
Yeah.
And if it's about a velocity, about people working and going forward and pulling together, then that's what we're trying to do.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And hey, by any means necessary, you know, we're not trying to bring them, but we're not running from none either.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's that serious. It's to that point.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And
now,
then,
you know, with all this, you know, talking about the black, we need to improve ourselves. We need programs. We need, you know, out of all this, one thing I never heard that the black youth, they need to know in depth their history.
Absolutely.
They need to know that they carrying their cell phone every day. They need to know that a black man created this cell phone.
Okay, now let me say this here. I understand exactly where you're going. But again, we know all of that. But if there's nothing in place of a school for them to learn about their history, then
it's not going to happen.
It's not going to happen. Because you can go on Facebook and they talking about it right now, but to know about all this, it's like, okay, are we just becoming knowledge junkies? We just like, oh, yeah, I know about this. Oh, yeah, I know the black people. I know it's a black man that invented a cell phone. Oh, yeah, it's a black man that did this here. Oh, yeah, it's a black man that built the White House. Oh, yeah, there was a black man that was the first president. We know these things, but knowing these things and being able to put these things in place to be able to put it back into the people, how do we bring that structure back?
Yeah.
Because, again, knowing about the history, that's one thing. But actually implement it and bring a history, you know, from the past up to speed to the now. How do we do that?
Because
a plan of action.
Because you can tell.
That's important.
You can tell a black youth. I'm going to give you an example for myself. When I had got into the knowledge and I started learning stuff back in the late, in 89, man, it gave me, you know, I was furious, mad about what they did to us. And then I was so enthusiastic in trying to make something happen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I was lost.
Mm-hmm.
Because I didn't know how to take the steps to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
So the music gave it the structure to make something happen. And from that music, made, you know, Flavor Flav had his phone number, you know, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And then the Nation gave it more structure. Mm-hmm. You know, then started developing, making clothes and things of that nature. So I see where it's coming from. The youth can get the knowledge, mm-hmm. but then they, like, you know, they feel like $1 million after they get it. They feel like they can conquer the world, mm-hmm. but they don't know how to channel that mm-hmm. strength mm-hmm. into building. Mm-hmm. That's what's missing.
Right.
But the thing about it is, a lot of leaders, today, either dealing with one or they dealing with other. Mm,
absolutely.
Instead of having both of them.
Absolutely.
Because you can have the structure, you can have them get jobs and build and stuff like that, but without the lack of knowledge, mm-hmm. you take all your money you earn and you mm-hmm. give it right back to the people mm-hmm. yeah. that, you know, you're trying to make money from. So you won't have to depend on them.
That's one of the things that we had a meeting
Yeah, it's very significant that you bring that up, because, you know, another way for us to create a stronger presence in the community, we want this to be a joint effort, you know what I mean? Not only moving products and getting our people back into the habit of spending with each other, but also organizing local events and raising awareness about critical social issues, you know what I mean? And whether it be economics, whether we all may bring people out today and allow them to learn about the usury system and what these banks really do to us, or we might have an event where we're discussing how to purchase land or how to do this or family dynamics, or, you know, critical history gives you a strong sense of self. You know, these things is going to bring us closer together. And if we could secure a venue and have, you know, a PowerPoint presentation, you know, this might be Saheed's, you know, this is my area. You know what I mean? I'm very informative when it comes to proper diet. Let me do a PowerPoint presentation. You bring the brothers and sisters and all the babies out, then you have the vendors all on the side, and we all coming together as a stronghold. So where is money being spent? People are getting educated, we raising awareness, and we doing so much, and we're coming and growing closer mm-hmm. together mm-hmm. as a
I
unit.
Mean, and even to what you're doing right here, really, this is a radio station. And how do we bring this radio station that's underground to the forefront?
Absolutely.
That's what we're trying to do. More or less, different leaders around the community and us as young brothers, we're trying to bring them all together and connect the dots. Mm-hmm. You know, because I may be a friend over here with this brother. This brother may be a friend with this one over here. And together, you know, we have to hear what the elders have to say, but also the elders have to hear what we have to say. And together we make a connection. Because the elders, the ones under us, they'll listen to us. Mm-hmm. And so on. That's how we bring it all together.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, one thing that black people got to be real aware of, that black people have been made to hate themselves so much. Mm-hmm. That you can organize, have a strong organization. Mm-hmm. But you... the lack of love for self, mm-hmm. which is, love for self is actually brought about through the knowledge of self.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Without that knowledge of self, you can organize, like Martin Luther King was saying on Brother Abdul Wakil's tape, organize. Mm-hmm. But without organization, it seems to fall apart in the long run, because lack of love for self.
Exactly.
You got jealousy, you got envy. Mm-hmm. You got all these things that come into play mm-hmm. that breaks us apart after we realize, yeah, we got to do something for ourselves. They're killing us, children.
That's why with the organization, that's why we have to really become family again.
Mm-hmm.
We have to really, truly love again. You know, that's just like we tell the brothers, you know, stop selling drugs, stop doing this. We can tell them this, but what do we have for them to turn?
What's the alternative?
What is alternative?
Right, yeah.
You know, so mm-hmm. I definitely can relate to where you're coming from. Yes, but we have to teach that love part.
But think about this. I'll use myself an example on that, too. I can be dead broke.
Mm-hmm.
Can't get a job because
mm-hmm.
of felonies.
Mm-hmm.
But it's something in me that would not mess with drugs.
That's right.
What is it? You know what I'm saying, Coach?
It's the God in you.
Yeah. Yeah. I done had a lot of times where I ain't had a dog. Mm-hmm. But I would never, ever touch drugs, man. Mm-hmm. Never. Mm-hmm. But I would never touch that. Mm-hmm. What is it that I done got that they not getting?
But it has a lot to do with consciousness, you know what I mean? The value of your life. You value your life. You value your situation. So, you know, when one deems itself lovable, even, you know, when you financially, you know, unstable, you know, just certain things that you're not going to indulge in, or certain conversations that you're not going to indulge in, because you understand that there's things at stake if I, you know, allow myself to be, you know, pulled in, you know, this, because I'm, you know, feeling a certain type of way because I'm not where I feel like I should be at.
Boom. Like this brother here, he said, and we was at his family's house. He told his family. He said, I don't need to be around people that's drinking and smoking. You know, so now order is being established, and they look up to him. Mm-hmm. So therefore, you know, if people we start building as family and as loved ones, you know, that has to weed itself out. You know, before long, if a person is still doing it, it's hidden. It's not so much open because you have people that's not on that and that's pushing that away from us.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, as cliche as it may sound, you know, love is the cure. And it's like the brother Saeed was saying, is that we have to go back to being family. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying? Because just like I said, we make all of our concerns one because we all have the same needs.
Mm-hmm. Same,
you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So his child is my child. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? And that's if it's not like that, then it's not going
to
work.
And it has to be a real love thing. Like you see when we walked up, it's a love thing.
Yeah.
I missed you. I hadn't seen you.
Yeah.
It's a love thing. It's real. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We for the ones of us that have that love, we know how to distinguish that hate amongst our people.
Right.
And activate the love.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's real. That's real.
Now, they get it. I mean, we may have it, but how do they get it?
What do you mean, they who?
The ones out here in the street.
I mean, they'll get it through demonstration. We got to give them an example of how it's supposed to look. Because right now, there is no, you know, nothing of sort of what we talking about at the plight that we really speaking on. There's nothing for them to look towards to really try to emulate a better way. The only thing that they really even being exposed to is, you know, brothers in the streets that's hustling and, you know, involved in gangs and, you know, so on and so forth. So what we do is we create, you know, we grab the like-minded individuals and we create a strong enough force where it'll be just more so a magnet, you know what I mean? And when people start to see it, like, this is really moving. This is, they making progress. They really having a strong impact.
Yeah,
and they gonna flop. They have no choice.
And overall, just to sum it up, you know, with us four right here, this is the beginning of it is by La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Just with that alone, and us having the Quran, that is the manuscript. Mm-hmm. We have to live according to what the book tells us. You know, and us that for us, thus to us to know, we don't reject none of the books. We add to that, and how do we add to it? By combining it. We don't discriminate on a brother because he's Christian, or because this one here is Black Panther, or because this one here is Nation Islam. This one here is Sunni. You know, one brother, Nation Man, said something so profound. He asked him. He said, "Are you Sunni? Are you this?" He said, "Brother, I don't divide Islam."
Yeah,
you know what I mean, and that's the problem, man. There's too much division, man. You know, but if you look at what Farrakhan is putting down, and what's so beautiful about it is that, you know, he reaches out to everybody as a branch, and he's a connecting force. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And if we was listening when we was there at the last Million Man March, he said some very profound things. But at the same time, you know, to bring it back to this city, it's like, man, what are we doing?
Hmm.
You know, this thing has to be in motion, man.
Say, for an example, if a child doesn't feel love, they won't love themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you take an example. How is it that people and suit and bow ties could go in a community
filled with drugs, filled with violence, and just stop it.
With no guns, just a walkie-talkie and walking around.
Love, structure, and being able to feel being able to connect with their people.
Mm. So, bringing that example to this, and like the work I do, you know, I can go through neighborhoods, you know, violent, it's crazy. But because they know what I'm about, they know that I'm trying to get them out of their condition into something better. You know,
how to reach the people that are out there in the streets is to be able to go to where they at. Yeah. And also to show connection with the people they so-called look up to. Because they have people in the streets that they look up to. They have people that they pay homage to and respect. So, again, it has to be a plan of action, man. We have to really be in the hitting the concrete, man.
In the trenches.
So, mm-hmm. when we talk about a job, this is a real job. Mm-hmm. This is one that's going to pay.
Yeah.
In this life and the next.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, when that happens, you know the first people that get upset?
Black people.
No.
Who's that?
The police. the police are the first ones that would start to slander you, start to come against you, try to get the community against you.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Because they get paid off from the drugs.
Right.
Yeah. They get paid off from the
property. They don't want crime to stop what you're saying.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And even the states have sued. Some private places have sued the government for not keeping the prisons filled.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, see, it's interesting that you say all of this because, see, this is what, see, all, like I said, man, a lot of us know these things, and so the key thing is that we have to be wise in our movement, you know, because the thing is, For those who truly believe and we put our trust in our Lord, is that we don't have no fear of whatever they come with. They're not going to be successful, you know, because we already learned from what they've done in the past, and they have always, like I said, they bring in the women, they bring in the drugs, they always cause confusion. And like I'm saying, that's why you have to have a strong moral code, strong moral code, strong moral code.
Understand this Flavor Flav. Payback RG. Yo, we gonna slam on with this one here. Kill that mumbo jumbo. Time to rumble in the jungle. Shooting shotguns at the lepers. Even lions is the shepherds. Now I ain't got time to chill, but I'm chilling with McGilla. And I don't mean at the pet shop, but up in Harlem at the wet shop. Eating on the side of wet sense. Jetsons, even the robot drank some oils, so she can lubricate the coils. Tarzan did his best to bust a nut and beat his chest.
You know, so because if, you know, because they're going to come to us at our weaknesses, be it drugs, alcohol, women, gambling, you know, our egos, whatever the case may be. So thus and therefore, we have to be protected. And part of our protection, like again, is being together.
And also, man, when you come to know this book that we follow, and that as a guide is the Quran, the Quran is a weapon. Mm-hmm. If you know how to utilize this weapon, how to access this weapon. See, it's one thing that they didn't want the people of African Americans to learn. It's what to say, why to say it, and when to say it. Mm-hmm. So, we come from an English speaking tongue, but if you learn this Arabic and learn what to say, you can protect yourself with this Quran. You can fight with this Quran. You can fight the unseen. You can fight them forces.
Now, what about the ones that don't follow the Quran? That just want to stick to their Bible?
Let me say this. Because, again, see, everything is through history. If we go back to the life of Rasulullah, again, after 12 years, 13 years of calling the people to Allah in Mecca. Once he left Mecca, he was ran out of Mecca. Because, see, when you come with causing dissension amongst the norm, meaning that you messing up the money, you messing up the system, you got to go. So they ran him out. Once he went into Medina and established what he was talking about, meaning he established the marketplace, he established the prayer, he brought that which was good, and it raised the people up. Once the people saw that, they said, we see that this is good, and they came by the thousands. See, that's our victory. See, once they see us doing this thing, they say, oh, man, them brothers are down. I like what they doing. I want to be with them brothers. Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
Just to throw it out there like this here. I had a situation, man. Me and a brother, we traveling, going, where are we going? Out of this city, going to a different city. And we end up getting jammed up. We get pulled over by the police, okay? We end up getting locked up, you know. I end up getting out. He end up getting out. We did our spiritual work, you know, because we really truly trust that Allah is real. And we know Allah. And when you come to know Allah, you fight with the power of Allah.
Yeah.
So these same people that thought they put a case on us, where whatever, we prayed on these people. And we prayed on their families. Huh? Mm. And these same people, when we went to court, the judge was a woman. Oh my God, I can't believe you guys really came. It was an ice storm in Iowa. Iowa froze messing with us. Because we sat there and we believed and trust and invoking the power of Allah, you know, praying on these people.
Allah. It's power.
Oh yeah.
The power of Allah is real.
It's real.
When you come to know the power of Allah is real. So
the only reality.
That's the only reality, man.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
So, you know, and when you truly come to trust and believe in Allah, your eyes are no longer your eyes. Your eyes become the eyes of Allah. Your thinking becomes the thinking of Allah. There's no you. If someone were to kill us, and if we really truly trust in Allah, and we purify in Allah, straight to paradise.
Ain't no devil for a Muslim.
Right, Allah.
That's it.
Allah is well.
But, you know, what they have taught the society, the media, they have said that Islam is terrorism. Is Islamist hatred. But you know, as you notice, they doing the same thing that their ancestors did. When they brought us to slavery, we couldn't be Muslim.
Islam liberates the people. The Quran, it liberates the people, you know, and it takes them out of a state of ignorance. Yep. You know, I used to be one of them people, so that's how I know wholeheartedly. You know, I used to be a drug dealing fool. You know, I used to be a slick, you know, fast talking con man.
Yeah.
I threw all that away for Allah. And like they say, the best of you in the dunya will be the best of you in this deen.
That's right. True that.
So when you truly trust in Allah and you do away with that, you know what? Hey, I'm looking for a job as we speak. But you know who pays my bills? Allah.
Allah Akbar.
Huh? Husband Allah. That's who paid my bills. Me trusting in Allah. Mm-hmm. Who make my car know? Allah. Who feeds me? Allah.
That's it.
Without doubt,
from Allah, everything is from Allah.
That's it, man.
From Allah to
and
Allah,
you know, even this meeting right here, man, this is nothing that we really designed or orchestrated. This is what Allah decreed. Each and every day, our feet is ordered by Allah.
Mm-hmm.
Sure is. And in that order, is by choice or by force, the people have to follow what Allah wants.
Mm-hmm. You know, I was telling brother Sean Kwali when he was over here and we did that interview, how do we keep it solid? We can start it, you know, say like, you know, when 19th magazine, my G, when I was cleaning it up and I was trying to put it back in order, trying to get all the brothers over it, and fell apart. And it's almost like it with every black people. You always come together and fall apart. How do we keep it solid? You know, where no cracks come in and make it bigger where we fall apart all the time.
Well, I'm gonna try to keep it brief because the thing is, we have to really understand the essence of the fret. To answer to that question, like I'm saying, and this is one of my sheikhs that told us, he says, in order for it to be successful, you have to be up under the same roof. You understand what I'm saying? Like I said, we really have to be family. And see, if that's not taking place, like I was telling the brother, you know, when the brothers get out, man, I tell them, say, we're not seeing each other every day, man, it's not gonna work. We got to be together every day. We got to pray together. We got to eat together. And most of all, it's about our trade and our business. We work together. You see what I'm saying? That's how it stays together. Because just like, you know, for those of us who have jobs, go to our job, we see our other employees every day. You see what I'm saying? We spend more time with people at work than we do with the people that we're supposed to be connected to. So that's why we can't be a wage slave. That's why we got to come together and generate income. It's like the brother was saying, it's about an economic foundation. That's what's going to make us tight. But like I'm saying, but some people fall off the side because sometimes the money is what makes people go astray. But again, man, like I said, we really have to understand what's in front of us, man. And like I said, it's about the love, and we've got to be family, man. We have to.
So you're saying the way to build that family, we gotta work together, gotta see each other. Gotta do things together.
You gotta do everything together.
We're walking on this journey together.
Yeah, man. It's like a pizza, man. You see everybody draw from one box, but they drawing from the same source.
Yeah. It's your slice.
Yeah. But what about when people get families? You know, they have children. You don't see them no more. Yeah. You know. And that pulls them away. Yeah,
because again, we have to have a community, man. We have to have a place of meeting, man. Everybody's scattered away, you know. His brother lived way over here in Zorn. His brother lived way over here. You know, it's too much, you know, division. Yeah. We have to come together, man. And this is a part of the visiting right here, man. You know. We have to incorporate all the teachings. You know something. He knows something. I know something. He knows something. And we bring all of what we know together, man, and put it in sequence. No matter who goes first, who goes last, we have to live out your ideas and your dreams and your vision. And so on, man. It has to be done with love and respect, man. I have to love your passion as if it was mine. Mm-hmm. I have to want for my brother what I want for myself.
Right.
So that's what we have to do. We have to put it in order in that way.
So how do we take the steps to do that?
Well, okay, this coming Friday, we have a meeting at 4 o'clock at California Community Center. And then on Sundays, we meet every Sunday at 2 o'clock. You can give them the address.
15 Garvin Place, that a new legacy. Oh Lord, but that's where we'll be meeting at, and then we'll just run down and discuss the whole agenda on what steps we're taking, because it's, you know, we got to focus on one thing at a time. Mm-hmm. Start delegating positions, everybody knowing what they're there for, what mission they actually need to carry out. That way all the wheels is turning at the same time.
And we definitely need you, because you can show us some things as far as the security part. You can show us how to do the checkpoints and checking somebody, because you know, we had a situation last time when we come in. There was a brother, you know, it was handled, but there was a brother that came in and his energy was real hostile, and like, you know, we didn't know what he was going to do. But at the same time, it got extinguished properly. But, you know, how do we keep that from, you know, happening?
Is this a meeting spot?
Yes.
A house? A rental?
It's a building. This is a building. This is actually a re-entry program. Mr. Powell, Ms. Giesler, they are directors over New Legacy. I'm a resident there, so they allow me to have my meetings there.
Okay. That's behind the Family Dollar, like
it's
on
behind, right,
the
yeah, family. Right there. Right. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
You know what it is, yeah.
Because I've saturated that area with literature.
Well, okay. I know for a fact myself personally, like somebody like yourself, you can help us in that area on how we keep from just, you know, how do we search somebody, you know, which way to search somebody, you know, you can teach us those things. So, you know, we have to work together, man, and, you know, put things in place, man, and go about it that way. I know you're very well familiar with that.
Yeah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسوله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سبحان رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام والمرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
That was beautiful.
Don't you know, John?